All right, good morning, everybody. Man, we're so glad you're here. I know there's some people out in the hallway coming on in, so you guys come on in. Let's get started. We're so glad to see you here today. Glad that you're here, and we hope that you have a good morning. I know that God has a lot for us today, and before we head into the worship service, I do want to just mention a few things that are important that are coming up in the life of our church here. One is our safety team training coming up this Saturday. And I know that sounds like something that's just for the safety team, and it is, but we would love to see more people involved with our safety team. And so if you have an interest in maybe becoming a part of our safety team, maybe volunteering once a month doing that, be at this training. This will be the perfect time for you to come, meet the other guys, get trained on how we do safety here at United. And so that's coming up this Saturday. And so just let us know, let me know if you plan on coming. Our own Tim Gramas will be leading that training. And so if you'd like to join the safety team, come on this Saturday morning at 9 o'clock. Those of you already on the team, you guys already know all of this, but we wanted to put the invitation out also. Also, I just wanted to make sure that you got a bulletin on the way in that's got all the information of things coming up this month here at United. And one of those, of course, is our annual Easter egg hunt. This is a community outreach for us where we get to invite our community in, love on them, share God's love with them. And so if you would like to be a part of that, it takes a small army to pull off an Easter egg hunt like that. And so on your chairs today, all of you should find a little volunteer sign up card. If you would like to be a part of this small army for the Easter egg hunt, we always have a blast. And so be sure to grab one of those cards, fill those out, and just place them in the basket back there at the Next Steps desk. You can place them there, give them to me, give them to Alex, whatever you want to do there. But just grab one of those cards and fill those out if you'd like to volunteer for the Easter egg hunt. And be praying for that as well. It's always a great opportunity for us to reach out to our neighbors here in this community, but also the people that you want to invite to bring with you. Be sure to invite your neighbors' kids, bring them here. They're going to have a great time in a safe environment, and we get to love on them and share Jesus with them. And so it's an awesome day, and we want them to be a part of that. And so thank you again for being here this morning. I want to just invite you to stand, and we are going to worship the Lord together.
I want to start us off with the scripture. In Psalm 100, it says, "Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations." So this morning, as we are entering his presence, let's enter with thanksgiving and enter with praise. And let's start our time with a word of prayer. God, we bow our hearts before you this morning, grateful for this opportunity to come together with your people and be in your presence. God, I just pray that we will be sensitive to your spirit, that you would work in us this morning, and God, that we would give you glory here, that you will be glorified in this place. We love you and give you all the praise. Amen. Sing this first song with us.
Jesus the Nazarene, and one
Blessed are those who run to Him, who place their hope and confidence in Jesus. He won't forsake them. Blessed are those who seek His face, who bend their knee and fix their gaze on Jesus. They won't be shaken. Come on and praise God. Fields of plenty. Bless God in the darkest valley. Every chance I get, I bless your name. Bless God when my hands are empty. Bless God with the praise that calls me. Bless God when nobody's watching. Every chance I get, I bless your name. Bless God when no weapon's for me. Bless God when the walls are falling. Bless God, cause He goes before me. Every chance I get, I bless your name. Bless God, for He holds the victory. Bless God, for He's always with me. Bless God, for He's always worthy. Every chance I get, I bless your name. Every chance I get, I bless your name. Grace, come on and leave. as we continue to worship with this next song, I just want you to think about the attributes. It talks about He's our strength, our shield, our rock. Just think about those words as you're singing this morning. God, I look to You. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like You do. God, I look to You. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do. God, I look to You. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like You do. God, I look to You. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do, yeah. I will love, and I will love You, Lord, my strength. I will love You, Lord, my shield. And I will love You, Lord, my rock. Forever, all my days, I will love You, God. God, I look to You. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like You do. God, I look to You. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do, yeah. And I will love You, Lord, my strength. I will love You, Lord, my shield. And I will love You, Lord, my rock. Forever, all my days, I will love You, God. Sing hallelujah, our God reigns. Lift this to Him. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Oh, hallelujah, our God reigns. Forever, all my days, hallelujah. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Oh, hallelujah, our God reigns. Forever, love You. I will love You, Lord, my strength. I will love You, Lord, my shield. And I will love You, Lord, my rock. Forever, all my days, I will love You, God. Let's declare one more time, hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Oh, sings forever all my days. Hallelujah. God, we just lift those words to you this morning, the highest praise. Hallelujah. Because, God, you are worthy of all our praise. Thank you for your presence with us this morning, your spirit that's with us. We love you and give you all the glory. Amen. You may be seated.
Right. Well, as we continue in worship this morning, as the video has just shared with us, the message there is, as we continue in worship, part of our worship is giving our tithes and offerings to the Lord. And so if you want to do that today, our offering stations are on the back wall just in front of the sound booth there. You're welcome to give anytime during or after the service. You can also give at uwchurch.com/giving. There's a whole giving page that you can give online and is super easy to set up and use. And so I encourage you to take advantage of that as well. But all that you give, all that I give, all of us that we give together, as we give that as a worship to the Lord, He uses that. He entrusts it with us to use to reach the people of this community, the people in your family, your friends, whatever we can do as a church to make disciples. And so thank you for your faithful giving. We couldn't do what we do without your giving, and so thank you for that. As we head into a time of prayer this morning, I want us to do something just a little bit different today. I want to share a scripture with you to prepare our hearts, but then one of the best things that we can learn to do spiritually is to learn how to pray through scripture and to pray scripture. Scripture is one way that we hear from God, but as we read it, we can also allow it to guide and shape our prayers. And so I'm going to read this for us, and then we'll go into a time of prayer together, and then I'll read back through it and give you some prompts to allow you to pray through this scripture, and we'll pray through this scripture together, okay? And so I'm not going to be leading you in a prayer that you just sit there and listen to, but I'm actually going to prompt you through scripture to seek the Lord today. That's why we're here. We have come for one reason, and that is to seek God, to seek Him, to seek His face, to seek His voice. And so Scripture is one of the primary ways that we do that. And so let's do that during this time of prayer. You can follow with me on the screen here. This is from Psalm 90. It says, Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the whole world from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. 1,000 years in your sight are like a day that has just gone by, or like a watch in the night. Our days may come to 70 years or 80 if our strength endures. Yet the best of them are but trouble and sorrow, for they quickly pass away and we fly away. Teach us then to number our days, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Satisfy us in the morning with your unfailing love, that we may sing for joy and be glad all our days. May your deeds be shown to your servants, to us, and your splendor to their children or to our children. May the favor, the blessing of the Lord our God rest on us, Establish the work of our hands for us, Lord. Yes, establish the work of our hands. Let's pray together and pray the scripture together. God, we do thank you for this day. We thank you for this time that we have, that we set aside week after week to seek you together as your people. Lord, we seek you through the week too, Monday through Saturday, but this is the special day that we gather as your people, as your family, to seek you together. And Lord, it's such a time that fills our spirits, it encourages us when we see each other seeking the Lord. And so, God, I just pray that in this moment, Lord, as we seek you, Lord, our hearts are open, our minds are open, our ears are open to you. We pray that you would speak to us. Lord, that this would be a time not of one-way communication, but this would be a conversation back and forth with you, communion with you together. Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the whole world, before creation, God, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. 1,000 years in your sight are like a day that has just gone by, or like a watch in the night. Oh God, this reminds us how awesome and mighty and powerful you are, Lord, that you have made and created everything that we know and see. And Lord, that you are eternal, but you were here before creation and will be here long after we're gone. And so, Lord, we want to praise you for who you are today. So now for all of you here, I just encourage you to take a moment and just praise the Lord. Worship him for who he is. Tell him how much you love him, appreciate him for who he is. Praise him now. God, we also acknowledge today that our days come to 70 years or 80 if our strength endures, yet the best of them are but trouble and sorrow, for they quickly pass. Lord, time passes so quickly and we fly away. Teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Lord, we confess this morning our sins. Lord, we confess this morning our need of you. Lord, we confess, we understand, we acknowledge, and we admit that, Lord, we are just a blip in eternity. Our 70 or 80 years, if we get that old, Lord, it's just a short time. And so, Lord, teach us to number our days. So just for the next couple of moments, I just encourage you to confess to the Lord, admit, acknowledge your need of him today. Acknowledge that he is God and that we are not. Lord, I know a lot of us come in here this morning discouraged, or maybe we're carrying burdens or challenges throughout the week. Lord, we have prayer requests that have gone unmentioned because they're just too, Lord, they're just too sensitive to share, or for whatever reason we can't share. And so, Lord, you know all of those things. We come today needing your joy and your love. And so, Lord, we pray that you would satisfy us in the morning with your unfailing love, that we may sing for joy and be glad all of our days. Lord, I pray that you would meet us right here, right now, in our hearts. Lord, we want you here. We want you in our hearts. We want you in our homes. We want you in our church. And so, Lord,
Help us to remember your unfailing love for us, that our joy may be renewed. I just encourage you to take a few moments as you pray and just remember God's unfailing love. Thank him for his love and for the joy that he brings to your life. Lord, we gather today to worship you, but Lord, we also gather together as your people to take your marching orders. Lord, you've not only called us together as your family, but you've called us for a purpose. You've given us a mission to pursue, a mission to accomplish together. And Lord, we want to just quickly admit that if we just go through the motions, Lord, if we just pursue the things that we want, then Lord, all of these things will not matter a whole lot. And so, Lord, we pray that your deeds would be shown to us, Lord, your splendor to our children. May your favor and your blessing rest on us, and that, Lord, that you would establish the work of our hands for us. You would establish those, not us. Lord, that we would be doing the work that you have called us to, not little side things, side projects, things that we want to do, but, Lord, that we would stay focused on the work that you have for us. So for the next few moments, I just encourage you to pray and ask the Lord and seek him in this moment to say, Lord, what are you calling me to do? How are you calling me to be a part of your work right here, right now, in this church, in this community, in your neighborhood? God, we continue to seek you, Lord, as we turn now our attention to your word and to Pastor Alex as he shares the word that you've given him this week to share with us. Lord, our hearts remain open. Lord, our ears and eyes and mind remain open to you. Lord, help us to see and to hear what it is that you are teaching us and what you're saying to us, God. Speak to us, we pray, in Jesus' name, amen.
Hello, hello. Good morning, United Family. How's everyone doing today? Good, good. I hope, pray that you are all doing well this morning. If you have a copy of the Bible with you, I would invite you to turn to the book of Romans. The book of Romans is where we will be today. Romans chapter 16. Romans is after the Gospels, after Acts. And at the very end of the book of Romans, you will find chapter 16. Thank you, Patrick, for leading us in prayer. The Dagen Hearts were on spring break this week, so I get the privilege of bringing the word to you today. As I was preparing for this sermon a couple weeks ago, I knew that I was going to be preaching today, and so I asked Patrick, I said, Patrick, what are we going to be in? What series are we going to be in for this sermon so I can kind of start preparing? And he looked at me and he said, well, none. No series. And I said, okay, well, that's good. Since we're kind of in a limbo stage right now between finishing our last sermon series and starting our Easter series, we prepare to talk about Christ going to the cross and his resurrection story. We kind of weren't sure if we would be able to fit in a whole new series, so we decided to have this as a standalone sermon. And he said, follow the Spirit. in your preparations. Follow the Spirit and preach on what God has put on your heart. Now, at first, you might think that this is very kind of Patrick, very such a good, lenient boss to let Alex just kind of preach on whatever he wants, and that you may be right in some ways. But also, if you look at the size of your Bible, there's a lot of things I could talk about, right? It kind of opens the door for all kinds of things. So I was sitting there, and I was like, how could I possibly narrow a specific thing for me to preach on? And I tried to press into what Patrick told me, to lean into what the Spirit was telling me and what the Spirit was guiding me. And so I looked through my Bible at the past couple chapters I had read in my personal devotions in the mornings. And I looked through some of my journals that I had been writing. And it kind of hit me. The Spirit was like, this is the one. This is the chapter. And so please know that this sermon comes from my daily devotionals in God's Word. It comes out of God speaking to me in His Word. And we titled this message, Gospel and Life. If you remember back to it was a year and a half ago now, we had a few sermons from this same series, Gospel in Life. So we're kind of coming back to this same question. The question of these sermons of Gospel and Life is, how does the gospel, the good news of Jesus, impact us in our daily lives? How does the gospel come into our life? The gospel is not meant to just change our heart or to save our souls, but the gospel is meant to bring us into good works that are a glory to God. So today we're going to look at how the gospel impacts our friendships. So we're going to read the passage right at the front end of the sermon. So if you would, it's kind of a long passage, but if you would follow with me in your Bible, Romans 16, starting in verse 1. This is what the Word of God says. I commend to you our sister Phoebe, who is a servant of the church in Cenchrea. So you should welcome her in the Lord in a manner worthy of the saints and assist her in whatever matter she may require your help. For indeed, she has been a benefactor of many and also of me. Give my greetings to Prisca and Aquila, my co-workers in Christ Jesus, who risked their own necks for my life. Not only do I thank them, but so do all the Gentile churches. Greet also the church that meets in their home. Greet my dear friend Epaphras, who is the first convert to Christ in Asia. Verse 6. Greet Mary, who has worked very hard for you. Greet Andronicus and Junia, my fellow Jews and fellow prisoners. They are noteworthy in the eyes of the apostles, and they were also in Christ before me. Greet Ampliatus, my dear friend in the Lord. Greet Urbanus, our co-worker in Christ, my dear friend Stachys. Greet Apelles, who is approved in Christ. Greet those who belong to the household of Aristobulus. Greet Herodion, my fellow Jew. Greet those who belong to the household of Narcissus, who are in the Lord. Greet Tryphena and Tryphosa, who have worked hard in the Lord. Greet my dear friend Persis, who has worked very hard in the Lord. Verse 13, greet Rufus, chosen in the Lord, and also his mother and mine. 14, greet Asyncritus, Phlegon, Hermes, Petrobus, Hermas, and the brothers and sisters who are with them. Greet Philologus and Julia, Nerus and his sister, Olympus, and all the saints who are with them. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All of the churches of Christ send you greetings. This is the word of the Lord. Now, originally I was thinking about having one of our dear students in our youth group read the scripture today. And then I thought that would be nothing short of a cruel joke to make them read all those crazy names. Because half of those I just kind of made up, and I was like, I think this is right, but I don't know for sure. I don't know if this is the right pronouncement, but I'm just going to roll with it. But I didn't actually just pick this passage today so that you could see all of the crazy names in the Bible, although do look for the baby announcement of little Flegon Wood at some point in the future. I might take that one right out of the Bible and use it for my own child one day. Flegon, that's not a good one. I think I'd be safer to choose John or Mark, maybe. I'm not sure. But no, as I said before, this passage kind of stuck with me when I was reading it in my devotionals. And it's kind of a weirder one to get, you know, to really stick out to you, but it stuck out to me for so long because of a trend that I have seen play out in my life throughout society and culture. Study after study has seen this trend become an increasingly large issue in our American culture in the past 20 or so years. And I truly believe that the church must respond to this specific issue. We must have a way to think through this issue in a biblical way. The trend that I'm talking about is the rise and increase of aloneness in our country today. Not loneliness, but aloneness. What I mean by that is, as Derek Thompson from The Atlantic said, he said, from 2003 to 2022, American adults reduced their average hours of face-to-face socializing by about 30%. That's adults. For unmarried Americans, the decline was even bigger, more than 35%. And for teenagers, it was even more than 45%. You see, we are increasingly alone in our culture today. This period in our history has actually, in a weird way, seen the largest rise in connectivity that the world has ever seen. We're more connected than ever. I was able to personally see this unfold as a missionary kid. My parents were missionaries. We moved when I was about 6 years old to Mexico, and we were in rural Mexico, like boonies of Mexico. And we moved there in 2006, and this was really at the heat of the great internet revolution. And when we moved, we were able to send something super cool to our friends and family, which was an email. Now, these emails in rural Mexico were not easy. We had to really focus in on our internet connection and find the right spots. And sometimes we'd have to drive far away to send these email letters to tell our friends and family, we're doing okay, ministry is good, praise the Lord, right? But then things started changing quickly, and I could see all of this happening. And before I knew it, there in rural Mexico, we had cable TV. And we were able to actually watch some things in America all the way in rural Mexico. We were able to keep up back in the day, back in 2007, 2008, American Idol was like the biggest thing in all of the planet, for at least my family, and I know for many other people. American Idol, every week, I was in rural Mexico following along with Ryan Seacrest to see who would win the big show. Then after that, we got something that was revolutionary called Skype. Skype, you know, it's like FaceTime, but worse, right? It was always breaking up. It was not a good thing. But back then, it was the best thing, right? Skype was revolutionary. And so things just kept getting more and more and more connected with the world around us. Most of you in here, except for a few of you, can actually remember seeing all this happen, right? You remember all of these changes happening right before your eyes. Cell phones and the internet and YouTube and all these things are connecting us closer and closer to the world around us. But this is kind of a trope that people say oftentimes nowadays, but it's very true. We are more connected than ever, yet we are more alone than we have ever been before. One journalist dubbed it the America's great hanging out crisis. We don't hang out anymore. We hang out a lot less than we did before. Now, I don't want to spend too much time setting up this issue of aloneness because you guys see it in your life. You guys probably can see how much more alone you are now than you were before. You have your screens, you have your TV, you have your things at home that you would rather spend time with than go out and be with people. We have all felt this shift from kind of face-to-face to screen-to-screen. It's happened right before our eyes. In some ways, it's a good thing. There's a lot of ways that being more connected has been a good thing, but in some ways, it's been bad. So we know the issue, but what we might not know is how our faith connects with the issue. We might not know what our faith has to say about our connection and our relationship with others. You see, what I think that we need today in the church is a stronger and a more robust understanding of the theology of friendship. Right? We have all these theologies, the theology of the Holy Spirit, theology of Christ, the theology of the spiritual gifts, but we need a theology of friendship. We must recapture the true, deep, Christ-centered relationships that once marked the church. We are called to be a city on a hill, and I hope that we can all be a city on a hill that the world can look at and say, you know what, I might not agree with their God or what their God has to say about the world, but man, they have deep community. I want some of that. One of my favorite authors, and some of you obviously know him, C.S. Lewis, he has a book called The Four Loves, where he compares four different types of love. And he reflects in this book how we have lost the value of friendship in our modern times. He says in his book, he says, to the ancients, to the people that have gone before us, friendship seemed to be the happiest and the most fully human of all the loves. The crown of life and the school of virtue. On the other hand, the modern world ignores it. It is something quite marginal, friendship. It's not the main course in life's banquet. It's a diversion. It's something that fills up the chinks of one's time. C.S. Lewis's big point is here is that we no longer even have a category for deep friendship in our modern society today. We've kind of lost that. We've replaced a lot of the categories of deep friendship with the categories of romantic and sexual relationships. Some of you may have heard before, but some modern and more progressive scholars have looked at the relationship between Jonathan and David in the Old Testament, and they have theorized that that might have been a homosexual relationship. And obviously we can see that that is so wrong, right? That is not the case, but these people, they look at the Bible and they see two people that are so close and deeply connected, and they say, well, they must have not just been friends. It's because we don't even understand deep friendship these days. We don't even have a category for it. And this is exactly why we need a robust theology of friendship. Famous Anglican pastor J.C. Ryle from the 19th century, he said this on the subject of friendship. On your screen, you'll see it with me. He said, this world is full of sorrow because it is full of sin. It is a dark place. It is a lonely place. It is a disappointing place. But the brightest sunbeam in all the world is a friend. Friendship halves our troubles and doubles our joy. What a beautiful quote. Friendship halves our troubles and doubles our joy. Obviously, we can see that the Bible truly values deep friendship. One of the most important opinion in the world, God our Father, the creator of the world, said in Genesis chapter 2, he said, it is not good for the man to be alone. This is in our nature. It's not good for us to be alone. We even see Jesus, who shows us the very heart of God in his actions. He made deep and close friendship with his disciples during his ministry. Speaking to them, he said in John 15, he said, I do not call you servants anymore, because a servant doesn't know what his master is doing. I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything I have heard from my Father. So, that brings us to our text today, Romans chapter 16, the one with all the funky names in it, where we see how the Apostle Paul's theology of friendship impacted his daily life, how the gospel impacted his friendships, how the gospel was lived out in his life. You see, the book of Romans, if anyone has ever read the book of Romans, you know that it is the depths of all theology in the New Testament. It is Paul's masterpiece of logic and theology and building the case for Christ. After studying God all his life and then seeing God through Christ, he puts all of that studying onto a book, and it's called Romans. He fleshes out the theology of God in Christ in the book of Romans. It has been said before that in the early years of Harvard University's law school, they would study the book of Romans as an example of how to build an argument, how to build logic. That's how amazing Paul builds his arguments for Christ. The Apostle Paul builds this case for why people all over the world need Christ. Whether they've heard about him or they haven't heard about him, we all need Christ for our salvation. He fleshes out a case for salvation not by the Old Testament law, by keeping the laws of the Old Testament. And he shows us how faith in Christ is the way of salvation. He builds on that argument. And then finally, he shows how a true faith in Christ leads to godly works, right? Good works. We see that all at the end of the book. And after all of this work, 15 chapters of meticulously building the theology of all Christianity, it all culminates here in chapter 16. It's the final chapter. So how does Paul end his letter? He ends it with people. He ends it with painstakingly naming 29, I counted, it took me a while, 29 different people in this passage. And there's even more, because if you look in your Bible, at verse 15, you can see it there. He says, greet all the saints who are with them. And then in verse, I think, 14, it says, greet the church that is with them. So he's talking to all these different people, but also the churches that they belong to. So there's all these different people. And honestly, I can't even imagine typing all these people out on my phone, like on a text. But he had to write them all. He had to painstakingly write them pen to page. This was not required. Paul could have ended his theological case for Christ in chapter 15. And it would have been just as impactful for Christ. But no, Paul concludes by greeting all his friends. So what can we learn today from this passage? Let's see. 3 points. First, I believe that we can see that the foundation of Paul's theology was people. The foundation of Paul's theology was people. Now, throughout church history, there have been a lot of different church movements. You can look through church history and see the movements of the church moving back and forth. And some movements have majored on theology. They think that theology is the greatest thing that you could ever put your life into. Just study God's word, study theology, study the doctrines of God. Now, there have been other church movements that have majored on people. They say, well, we don't want to get stuck in the doctrine and the theology. We want to go and impact people. Now, both of these sides are good, and I believe that we can see that Paul thinks that they're both connected. Paul's theology did not live in a vacuum, but rather existed for the building up of the people in the church. It existed for the people because people are the mission. That's something that we all need to strive for in our churches today and here in United. We need to remember that programs aren't the mission, that money is not the mission, that buildings aren't the mission, but that people are the mission. And so Paul builds this theology, but it's connected to each and every one of these people to which he is writing to. Now, we can also see from this that Paul didn't simply make friends. He didn't simply have relationships, but he built friends on the foundation of the love of Christ. And we see that Paul's friendships were very much Christ-centered. Now, in college, a couple years back, I lived on a hall at Liberty for 4 years, same hall, and it was like one of those classic halls that you see in the movies where there's just one big hall and there's a bunch of doors on either side of the hallway, and I lived on that for 4 years with 64 other men. It smelled a lot, just so you know, in case you're wondering. It smelled terribly, but it was awesome. I made tons of friendships because of the situation of all these doors lining up. It was like a little family. I had lots of friends, and some of them, a few of them, maybe two or three of them, were built on Christ. But a lot of them were built on anything but Christ. They were built on joking around. They were built on watching movies, playing video games. They were built on talking about small talk. Hey, how's class today? Hey, how's your homework going? Hey, look at the sun. The weather's good today. Isn't that amazing? Like, these really shallow things. And so a lot of my relationships, I regret to look back on and say, man, I could have built that relationship around Christ. Because it seems from this passage that Paul, he couldn't help but build his relationships and his friendships on Jesus. We see it all over the chapter. We see verse 2, he says, welcome her in the Lord. Verse 3, he says, my co-workers in Christ. Verse 7, he says, they were in Christ before me. Verse 8, he says, in the Lord. Verse 9, our co-workers in Christ. Verse 10, approved in Christ. And I could keep going, but I'll stop there. Paul kept reiterating it and building on the fact that he built his relationships in Christ. He was not satisfied with the ancillary talk of the day-to-day life. He wanted to get past the shallowness. He wanted to move past that and center his relationships on Christ. And so we have to ask the question, are my friendships marked by Christ, or are they marked by anything but Christ? Are my conversations with my friends Christ-centered, or are they anything but Christ-centered? Last point, we see that Paul saw friendships as a necessary and essential part of the Christian life. As I was reading this passage, I was kind of struck by how different I view friendships than the way that Paul and the original church viewed friendships. For my own life, friendships are, just like C.S. Lewis said in that quote, they're constantly getting my leftovers. They're constantly getting the leftovers of my time. They're like the leftovers in your fridge that you kind of forget about. They're in the back. And you're like, oh, I forgot about that Chinese takeout that I had back there, right? My friendships are getting the leftovers of my time. After my work, after my chores around the house, after the things I got to do, got to shop, got to buy this, after my personal alone time, you know, watching TV and recharging or whatever you want to call that, after all of that, then maybe I would get around to, you know, scheduling a get-together with friends or bringing people over to my house or going to meet someone for coffee. They were getting the leftovers. But for the early Christians, their relationships with the church were their lifeline. They could not do life alone. I was reflecting with a friend about the early Christians, and we were reflecting about it seemed that they didn't measure their spiritual life like we do. A lot of times we measure our spiritual life by how often we've read the Bible this week, right? How often have you read the Bible? How often have you done a devotional, prayed by yourself? These are good things. I think they're so good, but the early church seemed to measure their spiritual life based on how often they spent time with God, with others, right? How much communal time they spent with the people of God, right? Their spiritual life was both personal and congregational. It was both and. They were always spending time with others, breaking bread, having meals, worshiping God, learning about the scriptures from their teachers. in our modern times, we unfortunately have we've lost the desire for these deep friendships. We have replaced the deep friendships with surface-level connectivity. We're connected, but we're not deep. We have replaced time with people, which is super complicated and causes drama. People are complicated. They're sinners. Let's just be honest. We've replaced that with time with ourselves and our screens and our family and our house alone, just together, kind of isolated, because that's easier. That's so much easier to spend a night alone than a night out, right? A night by yourself than a night having to schedule with friends. But the thing is, while our desire for deep friendship has changed, we don't desire it as much, our need for it has not changed. Our nature, the way God made us, he said that it is not good for man to be alone. That has not changed. We still need these deep friendships, every one of us. We need a group of people that truly knows us, that knows our sin, that knows our struggles. We need a group of people and the type of friendships that Paul had built over his years of ministry. We see in verse 3, if you look at verse 3, about Prisca and Aquila. Prisca is also called Priscilla in other parts of the Bible, but we see Prisca and Aquila, they risked their own necks for my life, it says. That's the type of deep friendships Paul had built. How many of your friends would do that for you? How many of your friends would you do that for? All of these things are things that I've personally been wrestling with, that I've personally struggled with in my life. I have had a difficulty in finding true joy in the individualistic society that we've created here in America. Some of my, as I look back on my life, some of the more difficult times in my life were in my aloneness, in my loneliness. And some of the happiest moments were among deep and close friends. And that speaks to how closely friendship is tied to our spiritual life. It is interconnected. So the question that I came to personally, because I've struggled with this, is what should I do now? I wasn't even thinking, throwing this on you guys. I was throwing this on myself. What can I do? And so as I was meditating, I came up with three things that I feel like we can, places that we can start to look to build these kind of relationships we see Paul had developed. First, we must start small. I'm sure a lot of you, and because I'm know my wife, and she's very introverted, the idea of connecting with 29 people like Paul did sounds a little overwhelming. 29 people is a lot of people to be in deep relationship with. And so not everyone even needs that many people in their life. Some situations are different. Some people need different. Everyone needs people. It just might be a different amount. So focus on growing deeper relationships with start with one person or start with one maybe group of two or three or four people or maybe one family. Your family says, let's just grow closer to them for this month. Let's make this month all about inviting them over, getting coffee with them, scheduling things around all of our schedules. Schedules are crazy. It's hard to schedule a dinner with someone sometimes, but you have to be patient and work at it and start small. And then once you've built a relationship, the next thing that we must do to create deep relationships is gather around the Bible. This is something that is super hard to actually accomplish, I feel like. But if we really want true, deep relationships, we must be like Paul, who built his relationships in Christ, as we saw in the passage today. It was all in Christ. So when we when you have built a friendship, to take something to the next level is to read the Bible together, right? Whatever that looks like, maybe it's asking the friend, hey, let's just read the book of Mark together and let's meet up once a week and just talk about it. Or let's start a Bible study with this group. I know we have Bible studies in this church already, so maybe those deep relationships are already forming. Praise God. And if not, we are starting something called discipleship groups this year here in our church. Lord willing, these will begin to create some of these deep friendships that we long for and that we see in this passage. These groups are vulnerable, and they're accountable, and they're Bible-centered, and they're consistent. And so please talk with Patrick or me if you want information on that. But that's one way that we want to help you establish these types of friendships. Now, finally, third thing that we can do to create these friendships is stay the course. Stay the course. There's a phrase, you know, Rome wasn't built in a day. Friendships aren't built in a day. Paul worked on these friendships for years and years and years. And so stay the course. If you have friends, keep meeting up with them. If you have friends that you're like, man, we're kind of surface level with them, well, just keep at it. Keep at it. We must continue year after year. The slow, it's sometimes very slow, but the slow and rewarding work of building Christ-centered friendships in our life. There's a pastor, Eugene Peterson, who would describe discipleship as a long obedience in the same direction. He would just say, keep being obedient in the same direction and just keep at it for years and years. And I think the same applies to our understanding of friendships, of biblical friendships. We must be obedient to meet with people and encourage them with the scripture over a long time. And we'll see those deep friendships sprout from that. Now, in all these things to do that I gave you, these three applicational points, we must also remember that ultimately these aren't going to lead us to our ultimate joy, satisfaction, our ultimate contentment in life, because all of that comes from the man, God, Jesus Christ. He is our ultimate contentment. He is our ultimate friend. He is our ultimate joy. We will always be searching for something else until we put our searching in Christ. So with Christ as our foundation, then we can launch into and pursue these biblical and deep relationships. So let us all be a city on a hill that everyone can look at and say, they've found the deep relationships that my heart is longing for. I think it's something that in my generation, especially Gen Z, has felt deeper than any other generation. I talk to friends that are always just looking for deep community. And so we can be that community for people and cross the bridges of age and race and socioeconomic status and whatever. We can be the city on a hill. So let's do that as a church. Now, if anyone has been spurred on by this sermon, I pray that it spurred on someone here, and would like to dig deeper into the theology of friendship, I want to suggest a resource. I've been giving out books in our youth ministry like every week because I think books are helpful resources for people. So I wanted to suggest this one. This one's called Made for Friendship by Drew Hunter. Made for Friendship is what it's called. You can write that down if you want and purchase this. It's a really quick, it's 150 pages, really easy read, but I read a little bit of it for the sermon this week, and it was very helpful. I have one copy that I want to give to someone who wants to read more about this, and so if you would, I'll give this to you afterwards, but if you would just raise your hand, whoever wants it, first person to raise their hand will get a free book from Alex Wood. Who wants it? Anyone? 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 There we go. Boom. Got it. Let's go. So I'll give that to you afterwards, and you can read it and learn more about friendship. But if you want, you can order this. It came in like a day. So if you want to learn more, you can read that. But if you would, pray with me. Let's pray over our friendships and our community here at United. God, we thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you for the example that we see in Paul, the apostle, of how he built friendships, how he did not see people as something to be used. He did not see people as like a ladder to climb to to see greater success in his life. No, he saw people as friends. God, we long for that here at United. We long for that here in America, to see a life full of friends, a church full of deep friends. So I pray that we would learn the rhythms of friendship. We would learn how to go about that in our church. That we would start small, and that we would start gathering around the Bible together. And Lord, that we would stay the course over years. We continue to build deeper friendships here at United, and that those friendships would be an impact to our community. In your name I pray. Amen. Amen. If you have a Easter egg volunteer card for me, you can give that to me or drop it off at the table. But other than that, have a good week, everyone.